Let's go ahead and get started. Welcome, everyone. I'm Dana Austin, ORS Corporate Marketing Manager, and I'd like to thank you all for joining us for the second installment of 3 in our Data Center Fire Protection Fall Webinar Series. The topic of today's webinar is smoke detection in high airflow spaces. If you haven't signed up already for next week's final session, please do so. The topic will be fire suppression technologies for mission critical spaces. And just click on the link that's in the email that you'll receive after this webinar to register. We hope to conclude the webinar today by 4 o'clock, but before we begin, I'd like to take a few short minutes to tell you about OR Protection Systems. At OR, we are the mission critical fire protection experts. We provide fire alarm detection and suppression systems to customers across the country, and we support those systems with an industry leading national account service program. A little bit of history, OR was founded in 1971, so this year, we're celebrating 45 years of leadership in the fire protection industry. We are the largest privately owned fire and safety company in the country. We protect over $30 billion worth of assets against fire nationwide. Our branch offices and remote technicians are located strategically throughout the country, enabling us to meet the fire protection needs of our customers. And with our national accounts program, we service over 30,000 systems coast to coast. OR designs and installs virtually every type of fire suppression system available on the market today. OR is considered a premier partner with some of the most respected manufacturers in the industry, allowing us to provide our customers with the very best fire protection solutions. So we're not limited to just one or two manufacturers' products, and that vast network means better fire protection solutions for our customers' specific needs. OR's approach to service is simple. Do the job right the first time, and make it easy for our customers when they need us. Our technicians have an average of 8 years experience, which we think sets the bar for the industry. Our customers can rely on a single point of contact within OR to help with their fire protection needs, whether they have one or 100 buildings. Our technicians' vans are fully stocked and they're ready to address repairs while on site performing service. And what that means to our customers is no return trip costs. We fix it right the first time. OR is also ISO 9001 quality certified, ensuring consistency in our service, site to site and coast to coast. And because we understand all too well the critical nature of fire protection, we're available to our customers 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. Our proprietary online reporting system ensures that our technicians perform an accurate and thorough inspection every single time. The system also allows our customers easy access to inspection reports, failure trends, quotes, drawings, any and all relevant materials our customers need regarding their fire protection systems. It's all right there at their fingertips with just a login and a password. So to summarize, OR sets the industry standard for fire protection systems, service, and reporting. We're also committed to sharing our expertise through our blogs, seminars, and webinars, like the one you're participating in today. Just go to our website so you can benefit from the many expert articles and posts. It's all there to help you manage your fire protection system. And now, I'd like to introduce you to your speaker today, Lee Kaiser. Lee is our Vice President of Engineering. He is a fire protection and mechanical engineer, is a member of NFPA 75 for data centers, is on the FSSA Technical Committee, and has also been a volunteer firefighter for 19 years. Lee, welcome, and thanks for presenting today.
Thanks, Dana. Thanks for joining us this afternoon.
Can't hear me, huh?
Let's see. Can you hear me now?
No, sir.
Wow.
Please bear with us just a moment while we run through the technical difficulties. We'll be right back with you.
Hello, Dana. Casey, maybe you would let me know. Okay, you can hear me. Great. All right, so let's get started. Today, we are going to be talking about smoke detection in data centers, and specifically how to handle detection with in today's data centers that have such high airflow rates. So we're going to start out and do a little review actually from last week talking about strategies for detection. We'll talk about some of the technologies, detector technologies that are in use. We'll do a little review of what the codes require for data center smoke detection for data centers. We'll talk about some new code requirements that have come out in NFPA 75. If you haven't heard about that document, you'll learn about that today. And then finally, we'll wrap up with some practical applications for detector placement in high airflow data centers. Let's get started with this graph. This is a little bit of a review here. This graph, starting in the lower left-hand corner, is how fire grows from incipient stage to the point where there is visible smoke and maybe some flames to the point that there's intense heat within the room. That as you go from left to right on this graph, there is a higher and higher level of response. When we think about data center fire protection and specifically the strategy of smoke detection in a data center, we want to spend most of our effort trying to catch the fire as far to the right of the graph as we can. In a data center, what we really consider an incipient type fire is where we have maybe a circuit board starting to overheat and it's getting to the point where it's starting to produce non-visible smoke from that impending fire, or maybe overheating cables, you know, some insulation on the outside of copper wire starting to break down and start to cause some smoke. Really, at that point, we don't expect humans to be able to sense that there's smoke in a space. We are going to have to rely on technology, detector technology, to be able to know that there's something going on, okay? And we want to be able to know that something is going on, try to find it, and then deal with it as early in the timeline of ignition as we can, out of control, and we don't get to the point all the way over on the right where we have to do take some sort of suppression action, whether it's through a clean agent system, through water mist or sprinklers, or God forbid, have the fire department come in and start spraying in our data center. So if, again, for review, what would you do if you had time? Try to know about the impending smoke condition as, early as possible. Have a responsible human response in the incipient stage. Investigate the situation and try to do it before it's a life safety type concern and you have to evacuate the building. Have the people, the trained people on site, respond and try to find where that you might be having a problem before the fire department has to respond. We certainly, if there is a true emergency, we want the fire department to respond, but we don't want to lose control to the fire department unnecessarily before there really is a problem. And ultimately prevent unnecessary discharges. So that early detection in our building, in our data center space, gives us options, such as where we can try to find the problem, where we can respond proportionally, such as this checklist at the bottom, investigating with thermal imaging. We'll show that in the next slide briefly. Shut down the process that may be causing the overheat condition, especially if you find the smoke coming from a specific piece of equipment or overheat condition in a specific piece of equipment. Equipment level power off, where I just either unplug a server that may be having a problem, or maybe a power distribution unit, you know, one of those large power strip type things that they use on the back of racks, shut that whole thing down if that's the thing that's overheating. And then if you do find a fire condition with flames, use a portable fire extinguisher to address the problem. So again, for investigations, this is important. One of the things we highly recommend is the use of thermal imaging cameras to look for overheated equipment. Now, there's going to be a lot of warm equipment in a data center, but if I can use a thermal imager to find something that's really hot, I can possibly see that that may be the ignition source. So this the picture here on the upper right-hand corner is of a Fluke thermal imaging camera. You can buy those in from electrical suppliers, just like maybe your Fluke electrical test equipment. The picture below that is, you know, one of those cameras being used to see a breaker, a circuit breaker in a panel board that is overheating. This next picture I'd like to throw up is a picture of a FLIR, F-L-I-R unit. Mm-hmm. This is a consumer grade thermal imaging camera that plugs into a smartphone. It costs around $250 a unit, and it works quite well to do this investigation level thing that we're talking about in the data center. You can plug it into a smartphone. You can have a few of these for a pretty low or pretty cheap investment in your data center and walk around. This is the hand of our OR Protection Systems, our IT manager, and he's looking at this panel board that happens to be serving our data center because he knew that we have a few circuits that were overloaded in there, and we've since done a few electrical changes because of this. So we didn't want to pop a breaker and lose any equipment and therefore have any interruption to our own people inside the company or our customers. So just this wasn't for a fire investigation, but it gives you an idea of a pretty easy way to get into the game of thermal imaging in your data center. And then finally, that manual intervention. Once you've addressed or found the problem, if you do see a fire, you know, we want to use it with the smallest scalar's response as possible. Portable fire extinguishers are a great way to do that. In a data center, you should use clean agent type or carbon dioxide extinguishers. Do not use water-based or foam extinguishers. Don't use dry chemical extinguishers. That will just cause a bigger headache than what you need. NFPA 75 gives us some guidance. For every 3,000 square feet of floor space in the data center, we should have an extinguisher with a maximum of 75 feet of travel distance to that extinguisher. Locate the extinguishers at room entrances as a general rule so that you need to go towards an exit from the room before you grab an extinguisher and go back. And then provide training to workers on how to use extinguishers. So let's talk a little bit about detection, okay? In the concept of data center fire protection, we look to one document we haven't discussed before, NFPA 76. That's a document that's used for telecommunications facilities. It is sort of referenced by reference into NFPA 75, the standard on protection of information technology equipment rooms or data centers. And NFPA 76 gives this idea of three levels of smoke detection: standard fire detection, very early warning fire detection, or early warning fire detection, and very early warning fire detection. So those three levels. And as you move from standard to very early warning, the sensitivity, the ability for that detector to pick up a problem in the space increases, and the spacing, the distance between sensing points or detectors decreases as you move from standard to very early warning. This graph shows it a slightly different way, and this is actually a pretty good way if you're a specifying engineer to specify detection in data centers. This matches how the air sampling smoke detector manufacturers say to do detection, and that's in NFPA 72 under air sampling type smoke detectors. It refers the designer of that system to use the manufacturer's recommendations for spacing and sensitivity. So this is sort of what those types of manufacturers use for their information. So let's start in the upper right-hand corner for standard fire detection. For standard fire detection, you should space detectors or sampling ports, if you're using air sampling, at 900 square foot per sampling port or detector. And then the sensitivity to smoke should be set to go into alarm at 2.5% obscuration per foot, okay? So obscuration per foot is a measurement of smoke density. It's an optical smoke density measurement for spaces, and that's how the smoke detectors are rated, okay? So 2.5% obscuration per foot for standard fire detection. Early warning fire detection increases sensitivity and decreases the spacing, so locations get tighter together at 400 square foot spacing, and then 1.5% obscuration per foot. Now, when we went to very early warning, where we want to know about a fire problem as early as possible, we dropped down to 200 square foot spacing and a sensitivity of 1% obscuration per foot. So that's a pretty sensitive detector. To give you an idea, most off-the-shelf spot smoke detectors, photoelectric type spot smoke detectors, operate between 1.5% and 2.5% obscuration per foot. When we drop it down to 1, we're going to alarm earlier. And so if you understand that concept, know that very early warning fire detection gives us an alarm earlier within our space. Now, air sampling smoke detectors, which we will talk about, give us the ability to know about smoke in our data center before we get to 1% obscuration per foot at the sensing locations. So pretty technical discussion there. Let's move to this next slide, which is a chart of where you might use standard early warning or very early warning. We have different rows broken up by different functions within a data center type building. In electrical distribution rooms, which is from our experience, there are fires that happen in distribution rooms, switchgear rooms, rooms with transformers, panel boards, those types of spaces have fires. And we suggest using very early warning fire detection spacing and sensitivities in those types of rooms. One of the big critical issues over there is accessibility at the ceiling. So detectors need to be located at the ceiling. That's an NFPA 72 National Fire Alarm Code requirement. But electrical rooms with all the conduits and things running up at the ceiling make it hard to access detectors at the ceiling level up above rows of conduits. So we highly suggest using air sampling with a very early warning fire detection approach such that we can service that detector mounted at chest height easier than spot smoke detectors up at the ceiling for those types of rooms. Battery rooms are a little bit different. We suggest early warning fire detection. One reason we don't step up to very early warning in a battery room is mostly because they generally don't have high airflow environments in battery rooms. Typically, there's not a lot of heat for a dedicated battery room, and the air handling in that room won't be to the point where I'd need to really rely on air sampling ports being densely spaced within that area. Generator rooms, another critical function, so it gets very early warning. The server hall itself, we say data centers, and we always think about the room where all the racks are and the IT equipment is, but it's really all these rooms that build the whole data center space. But the actual server hall itself, very early warning, as you would expect, is suggested, mostly because of the criticality of the room, the potential for air containment, high airflow rates, an unknown movement of smoke when with all that airflow, and then the potential of suppression systems being there. We want a high quality of detection in those types of spaces. Now we move into these next three administrative spaces, like offices, the loading bay for preparing equipment to move into the data center space, and the warehouse. You know, all those are places where standard fire detection using spot smoke detectors is acceptable. You know, those are good things to suggest. We would not suggest having a data center build out with only smoke detection in the server hall, generator room, battery room, electrical rooms. We'd want you to have smoke detection throughout the whole facility to have good early protection. And then mechanical spaces, another place where access to the ceiling is hard, but the airflow, air exchange rate wouldn't be that high, so early warning fire detection spacing would suffice. And then potentially the air intake structure, so like the outdoor air intake to a data center. We see more and more data centers going to a HVAC strategy where they're using 100% economizer, the air that's being brought into the data center needs to be checked for smoke, believe it or not, and maybe even other contaminants. This becomes pretty important in areas that have regular wildfires out west and to the southeast of our country, of the United States. If you are in a place where wildfires are present, you could be bringing that smoke into your data center, and you'd want to have detection inside your air intake structure so that you could know that there's smoke present and then use the building automation system to shut down outdoor air for that time being so you weren't bringing in that smoke from the outdoors. The types of technologies that fit standard early warning and very early warning, air sampling, smoke detector systems, seen at the top there, that technology fits the bill for all three. There are laser spot detectors. These are different than conventional spot detectors based off of photoelectric technology. Laser spots have a laser like air sampling detectors do, and it can be used for very early warning fire detection. Spot detection, conventional spot detection, based again off of photoelectric technology, can be used in standard and early warning, and then beam detection even for spaces where beam detectors make sense can be used for standard fire detection. And so another way to sort of space the, discuss that, the increases in technology shown on the left and going from left to right, the increase in performance, basically the highest type of detection you can buy as far as technology and performance is aspirating laser air sampling detectors. Some questions. This is a great picture here on the bottom. What we see are two different installations of detection on the same type of air handling equipment. These are computer room air conditioning units with returns on the top, and on the right, a very busy, industrious contractor installed photoelectric spot smoke detectors to do detection coming into the return air grill. Versus the installation that they wound up doing, because the system on the right never performed. The system on the left performed using air sampling. A much cleaner installation, easier installation. So we worry about well spot detection when there's a lot of air moving by them. Generally, they can have problems, especially if there's dust in the air. What way is the airflow going to move? You can see in the picture on the right, the detectors are installed upside down. The code doesn't allow you to do that, so that was a bad call by that installing contractor. Is the in that high airflow situation, is the detector sensitive enough? And frankly, in today's data centers, we see high airflow conditions such that we might see at the intake to these crack units all over the data center. So sensitivity under airflow is a big deal, frankly. Temperature performance. Air sampling detectors and the sampling ports will handle higher ranges of temperature swings. Really, what we're worried about is the top-end temperature, where we have data centers now raising the intake temperature to the cold face of the servers. The leaving temperatures can exceed the listed rating of spot smoke detectors. Usually, most spot photoelectric detectors top out at 120 degrees Fahrenheit. If you're running your data center with a 85, even 90 degree intake temperature to the cold face of the server, you can exceed that in the hot aisles. Placement and accessibility. Air sampling is very flexible in its placement, especially for return air grill sampling like in the pictures, but also with respect to ceiling locations and accessibility. Mm-hmm. The ability to service an air sampling detector in the long run, comparing that against spot detectors where you have a large number of spot detectors up at the ceiling, you can save yourself a lot of headache by choosing air sampling. So air sampling, if you haven't seen that technology before, you should be exposed to it. Air sampling smoke detection is a different type of smoke detection that's been used in data centers for a number of years now. We're probably on the fifth or sixth generation of that technology now. And what it consists of is a centralized detector mounted usually at chest height, where a servicing fire alarm technician or the owner can access that unit. And then out of it, we run a series of three-quarter inch CPVC pipes to the place that we want to have smoke detection. A lot of times that's going to be the ceiling. And in that pipe, we drill holes, okay? So back in the detector, there is a fan or aspirator, and that fan provides suction to those pipes, which sucks air that's in the room back into those sampling holes through the pipe back to the detector. Inside the detector, then we have a detection chamber where we're actually looking in the air, is there any smoke, okay? And if smoke is seen, we measure how much smoke is in that air. And then we know at what level of response to have based on the amount of smoke that we hear or that we see in the detection chamber, okay? It can be used for very early warning fire detection and give us detection at those incipient stages of a fire that, again, could last, you know, hours or days before we'd even perceive it as a human with our own senses. It's active detection. It's constantly sampling the air within the room and not waiting for smoke to get to it passively, like what spot smoke detectors do. When we talk about air sampling, this is an important slide to bring up. Air sampling, again, to emphasize this, can be used for stage one of a fire, the incipient stage, to know that there's smoke in a space like that, give us some warning ahead of time. At stage two, where we have visible smoke, that would be where spot smoke detectors would first let us know that there's a problem. Where we have flames visible, that would be in stage three, where optical flame detectors would first let us know that there's a problem. And then finally at stage four, where we have heat, that would be where heat detectors or even sprinklers would let us know that we have a problem. And we can adjust the sensitivity settings for air sampling smoke detectors, or any installer can, so that you give an alert level, an action level, and a fire, two different levels of fire warning notification based on the conditions that you have inside your space. So really clean spaces like data centers, we usually set up that fire one notification at 1% per foot obscuration, and then we may actually activate detection up at, or suppression, pardon me, up at higher levels, maybe at 3% obscuration per foot. So we'd let the fire build up before we'd actually release the suppression to make sure that we really had something worth releasing on. So current codes, what if I was just to start to do a code analysis to see what is required in my data center, it kind of go like this. Data centers in the model building codes are considered business occupancies. So under the building code, such as the International Building Code, no detection would be required in a business occupancy. In the life safety code, same thing, no detection required, okay? But there is an occupancy standard for data centers, and if we choose to follow it, it's called NFPA 75, which again is the standard for the fire protection of information technology equipment. It is a voluntary standard in many jurisdictions. It's code required in some, but mostly it's a voluntary standard. And so if we look into that and perform a risk analysis according to Chapter 4, which is entitled Risk Considerations, we see that we have a fire risk, then we should, the standard says we should follow the prescriptive requirements in later chapters of that document. For generally, if we see in our risk analysis that detection is going to be required, smoke detection will be required. Smart smoke detectors or air sampling is acceptable, should be at the ceiling level throughout the information technology equipment area. Of course, there may be some other areas that we want to add it to. It should be below all raised floors that contain cables. And then it should operate smoke dampers when we have it installed above suspended ceilings and raised floors. So if there's fire smoke dampers on ductwork providing air to that space, the smoke detection should operate those fire smoke dampers to close. Okay. Now that's really only if we're using those duct systems to circulate air to other parts of the building, or that HVAC system is serving the data center space from the other parts. If you just have self-contained HVAC, like computer room air conditioning units, crack units, then fire smoke dampers wouldn't be required. In 2014, the industry started to become highly aware of the need for better research into how smoke behaves under higher flow environments. And so the Fire Protection Research Foundation is a wing of the National Fire Protection Association, NFPA. They performed a research project called the Validation of Modeling Tools for Detection Design in High Airflow Environments. Okay. And so it was a research project that looked at how smoke moved in basically data centers, because that's the rooms that we are really highly considered to be higher flow environments. And it gave us some information that has been moved now in the code making process into NFPA 75. And I want to take a chance to highlight some of that new information in NFPA 75 and what's required now under the 2017 edition of NFPA 75 versus what was previously required by that standard. First off, we are to provide early warning fire detection in two locations, okay? We need it in the exhaust or return air stream where aisle containment systems are used. So if you have aisle containment installed in your data center, such as in this picture, the highlighted orange area is the return air stream from that hot aisle containment system. So air sampling or very early warning fire detection, you probably using air sampling detectors, should be installed in that area, okay? Another location is in the return air stream where the above ceiling area is being used as a plenum. So if you're using the plenum in your data center as an airflow path back to the HVAC equipment, then you need to have early warning fire detection, smoke detection up in that area also. So those are two new requirements out of NFPA 75. But there's a lot more information included in the annex. So we consider this to be supplemental information. Some authorities having jurisdiction or fire marshals out there enforce the annex and some don't, but you need to be aware of it. The first recommendation is that installation of detection at the ceiling is fundamental to all information technology equipment rooms. So having detectors using whichever technology at the ceiling is fundamental, okay? You can't really get rid of that. And there's the concept of what this research project showed us is that in incipient stages of a fire, when smoke is coming from the ignition source at a very low energy, it doesn't have a lot of buoyancy. So it tends to move completely with the air handling system. So the smoke will move along with the air being returned back to the air handling system. So ultimately, detection sampling ports need to be put along that airflow path, but you can't just assume that the ceiling does not come into play. So that's point number one. Fundamentals of detection in an information technology equipment room or a data center, same difference, is at the ceiling. Okay. Second, in the data center room, the higher the air exchange rate or velocity of the air, the more dilution of the smoke. Okay. So the faster we move air, the more volume of air we move through, the more smoke is going to dilute, which means that we must take extra steps to have a higher performing smoke detection system. Okay. Number three, when fires are small, the smoke moves with the HVAC airflows, not its buoyant forces. So smoke isn't necessarily, when the HVAC is running, it's not necessarily going to go to the ceiling. It's going to move along with the HVAC airflow. So we need to try and capture it along that path. Four, we need to focus on installing sensors or ports in the exhaust ventilation air envelope. So we're going to show you some practical ways to do that and some diagrams here, but we need to focus on those locations. Five, locate sensors or ports at strategic points where smoke will pass. We'll talk about that. And then six, install detection equipment to be suitable for the conditions present. That's both the temperature and the velocity, okay? So looking at number four again, install sensors or ports and the exhaust ventilation air envelope. The best opportunity to do that, to detect smoke at the incipient stage, is to have detection along the airflow path. So here we can see that this diagram shows hot aisle containment in a data center. Smoke's coming from somewhere on the left in that contained aisleway. Some equipment there is starting to overheat, causing smoke, and so we want to, along that airflow path, have detection. Now we potentially would also have it along that airflow path at a return air register, okay? So that goes along with point number five. Locate sensors or ports at strategic points where smoke will pass, such as hot air return streams and return air registers. So we can see one picture here on the right of air sampling pipes being installed in front of return air grills. And so that's a fundamental strategy that's been used for years in data centers and telecommunication spaces. There's been lots of fires and even more low-level smoke events that's been captured by this type of technique. The last recommendation in the annex is when we use detection for suppression systems, there's three things that we should be doing, okay? First off, we should use a logical confirmation of the presence of products of combustion, so smoke, right? Single indications shouldn't release the system. So what it's telling us to do is something that we've done for years, is use cross-zone smoke detection or a double knock type system where it takes two detectors to confirm the presence of smoke before we will release the suppression system. It also says that we should release the smoke from smoke sensitivities between 1.5% and 3% obscuration per foot. That's the recommendation in FPA 75. So we don't necessarily want to release from 1% obscuration per foot, which is what's required for very early warning fire detection. We want to wait till the smoke builds up higher. So if you're thinking about this with, and you're familiar with the use of air sampling smoke detectors, we'd want to wait until we get to fire two on a detector and have it set appropriately so that fire two setting would represent a smoke condition at the sampling port between 1.5% and 3% obscuration per foot. And then we should only release from detector spacings at 200 square foot per detector or less, okay? And so, we want fairly tight spacing. Some of the manufacturers of suppression systems say no greater spacing than 250 square foot per detector. Now, NFPA 75 is taking a stance and saying 200 or less. So we install lots of systems at 200 or even 125 square foot per detector, and even denser detector spacing. All those things would be in compliance with this, starting at 200 foot square foot and below. Now let's kind of move into some practical examples. Placement: where should I place detectors or sampling ports for my air sampling smoke detection system in hot aisle and cold aisle or other configurations that are used out there to overcome some of the challenges of cooling in data center spaces? So hot aisle containment is a technique where we capture the hot leaving air from the hot face of IT equipment and then bring it back to the HVAC equipment. So this diagram tries to show that, where we blow cold air into the room, usually from a subfloor space up through ceiling tiles. It goes through the equipment and goes into the contained hot aisle and goes back into either through ductwork or through the ceiling plenum back to the HVAC units or crack units to be cooled back down again and blown into the subfloor. So how do I assess hot aisle containment? Where should I put it? Well, this diagram shows us a few places. The red dots are places that we should put detection. First off, we see red dots at the ceiling. Remember that ceiling detection is fundamental to all data center spaces. Next, we should put detection in the hot aisle, the place where we transition from the hot aisle up into the return air plenum or to wherever we collect it with ductwork. Another place we should consider is up in the return air plenum. That's another place where we could capture smoke that's moving along with the airstream. And the final place we should consider it is at a return air grill to the crack unit, or potentially we see this detection at the discharge from the unit. So you may have a concern that I want to have it at the discharge since I have it in the ceiling plenum space. Now I want to have it at the discharge from the crack unit so that I could maybe capture any smoke due to a failed motor, blower motor condition or a burn up drive belt inside of my crack units. And frankly, we've seen a lot of those types of situations where that scenario will discharge smoke into a space or cause smoke to be put into a data center space. Now, this is important. So for smoke detection systems to be able to detect products of combustion with a sufficient level of smoke, it must we have to have detection in that travel from the source to the port, and then it has to arrive there in a sufficient density to be detectable. So again, put detection where we're going to have it. So we saw in the diagram, it changed from a recirculating system to to an economizer system. We want to know that we've got detection along that airflow path so that we can find it. When we're an economizer, we're not going to build up enough smoke in the space for those detectors up at the ceiling to ever know that we've got a smoke problem in our building. When I put air sampling detection in hot aisles, here's some good guidance for that. So maybe you need to put into your specifications. For any collar penetration, such as chimneys or hot aisle containment, we need to have one sampling port for every 6 linear feet of ducted space going up into for the hot aisle. So that's a way to do it. Specify a sampling port every 6 linear feet. Where I've got a ducted chimney system, and there's some manufacturers that make chimney systems, such as what's shown in this picture, then I need to have one sample port for every 4 square feet of chimney opening. That's very similar to return air grill spacing that's called out in NFPA 76. And then the orientation of those holes needs to be at 30 degrees, between 24 and 45 degrees to the direction of the incoming airflow, the downward direction of the incoming airflow. So over on the right, you can sort of see what that means. We don't want that sampling hole to be directly into the airflow, directly parallel to the airflow, and we don't want it perpendicular to the airflow. Best performance happens towards the area, the direction of the airflow, between 24 or 20 and 45 degrees. Usually what that means from a practical perspective is we run the pipe, put the holes in it, and then we put we install the pipe with a union so that we can loosen the pipe union and rotate that pipe so we can get that angle exactly correct. With the concept of sampling every 6 feet, we want to have our spacing tight enough so that we don't miss smoke. So every 6 feet is what the air sampling manufacturers have sort of come up with as a good rule of thumb. We have seen that in some fire conditions where there low energy smoke event happened to be a power distribution unit that failed and caused a little bit of smoke, and there was air sampling at the in the return the contained hot aisle, but it wasn't tight enough. And so now new recommendations have come out from the manufacturers every 6 feet. So that's what should be in your specifications. Cold aisle containment. This is a different strategy where we contain, you can see the, these blue areas, the cold air coming up, blowing into the cold face of the servers. It goes through the IT equipment, warms up, and it goes into the room. Generally, these are hotter rooms when you walk in because we've contained the cold aisle or the cold air, but now we just feel the warm air blowing back to the crack unit. So a slightly different strategy for cold aisle containment. We don't actually recommend putting sampling ports at the inside cold aisle containment roofs. We don't think that it will work, okay? We think you should save your money and you're better off putting detection at the ceiling, again, fundamental, and then putting detection along the path of return back to the air handler. What happens inside the cold aisle is there's a dead air space, and that can be seen in CFD models of air distribution. At the top of that cold aisle roof, there's just no air movement, so smoke, even if it was in the airstream, wouldn't make it to that point, and it really would be pretty useless. So we don't recommend that. These are the places we recommend it. Plus, again, if your return air plenum is, or your ceiling plenum is being used for returning air, it should have detection in there, and then turn grill, or maybe at the discharge if I want to capture a you know, blower motor failure again. So to put it in words, cold aisle containment, place detection sampling ports at points where the hot aisle prior to dilution, and then at every 4 square feet of grill area or protected space, same orientation suggestions. Some aisle containment strategies use in-room coolers, okay? We don't see this too often, but there are definitely data centers that use in-row cooling units for recirculation into and out of the row. We suggest detection located at points where the hot air exits before it can be diluted into the room. Again, same spacing rules. One sampling port for every 4 square feet of grill space, and same orientation rules, so at 20 to 45 degrees towards the incoming air. So that sort of wraps us up. A lot of information there. If you have questions, we'd invite you to ask us those either through the chat feature on the webinar, or to send us an email with our email, my email address that's shown there, or through social media. Dana, do you have a few things to wrap us up this afternoon?
I sure do. Thank you, Lee, for another wonderful presentation. We appreciate it. To our guests, this concludes the second installment of Worst Fall Data Center Fire Protection Webinar Series, and we do appreciate all of you attending. If you, as Lee said, you can email him if you have any fire protection issues at your facilities, but please just don't hesitate to reach out to us and connect with our fire protection experts like Lee, because Lee and the rest of the team can help you with a fire system issue that's causing you pain. Now, you will be receiving an email shortly with a request that you complete a quick, less than 2-minute survey. We strongly ask that you complete that survey. We will send you a gift as a sign of our appreciation for that, but it'll also help us to just keep making our webinars better and better for you. So please help us out by completing that survey. In that email, you'll also find a link to register for the final webinar coming up next week, and we do hope that you will join us for that as well. That about covers what I had here. Again, thank you so much for participating, and I hope everyone has a great day.
Thanks, Dana. Bye, everyone.